today has the same letter structure as seen back in the 3rd century BCE. However, the style of the letters has been greatly influenced by European calligraphy, technology, and typographic conventions. We shall split our time between an overview of the Hebrew alphabet and then compare a few key differences between the Hebrew and the Latin letter. My interest in Hebrew typography spans over 20 years from my MA thesis, which investigated design considerations affecting the simultaneous use of Latin and Hebrew typography. Since then, and to introduce myself, as I reckon no one will be able to introduce me, I'll briefly outline some of the other areas in graphics that I'm involved with. In 1986, we took delivery of one of the first two PostScript image setters in the UK. Those were the days when there was only 14 PostScript fonts available, and one could only set up to 3 variations on a page. That was actually a feature which, unfortunately, they did away with more recently, when you see the state of what can come out in some design studios. At the time, we also were responsible for typesetting the first issue of the typographic journal that made use of PostScript typesetting. The following year, with our links with Adobe, we were introduced to Royal Dalton, who were looking for some software to take what was then Adobe Illustrator version 1 vector files in 1987 and bend them around plates. We developed an application for them to do this, bending vector work, back some, well, it's nearly 20 years ago now. Then in the 1990s, with the development of Photoshop, the application evolved to include the manipulation of pixel data and also the visualization of designs straight onto a photograph of an image. Then coming back to type now, variations of the application were also developed for the manipulation of text for various industrial processes. Here, a metal tin can is actually pre-printed before it's punched out of to form the sides of a tin. And so all the artwork text needs to be distorted to accommodate not just the compression to form the walls, but also the metal stretches more the further out it goes, and so compensation for that is also applied. These are a range of different specialist applications that we are involved in. Moving up to the 1995s, we then expanded into colour management. Typesetting, image setting suddenly became the job of colour as well, and we now have a web shop supplying colour management tools to designers and photographers, which is supported in 5 languages and the largest in Europe, and we're also involved in a lot of colour-related consultancy. Tying back to type and manuscripts, we're responsible for working with the Bodleian Library in the accurate colour capture of manuscripts for their digital archives. But similarly, we work with the likes of the British Library, controlling the colour of their output. Also involved with contracts with the likes of national magazines and the government and Ministry of Defence, all relating here to colour. Another specialist application we got involved in is making 7 colour separations for certain print processes, such as in the ceramics industry and enamel onto metal walls like these here at a Singapore metro station. To achieve the equivalent of 4 colour offset printing, you actually need 7 colours, and we've developed software to make those 7 colour separations automatically. Then, bringing colour back into type, we actually happen to be advisors to FIFA and UEFA on legibility of numbers on shirts relating to the colours, and developed specific software for them here for checking the kits so that there's enough contrast and colour difference between numbers and backgrounds, but not too much contrast in striped shirts that will interfere with the legibility of the numbers, and even measuring the level of reflective quality of the numbers to avoid any confusion on the pitch. So that brings us up to date, and now back to Hebrew typography. Can I have a show of hands? Who here is familiar with the Hebrew alphabet? A few, okay. If those few can sit on your hands while we do a little experiment with the remainder of you, The experiment may not work as you recently saw he drew on the screen just before from Paul, but we'll go with this anyway and see what happens. Here we have a sample of the Hebrew block letter dropped down as just a section out of a page. One is the correct orientation, one is upside down. Could I have a show of hands of those who believe the lower sample is the correct way round? Okay. A bit less than half, which is reasonably good considering people have seen this earlier on. And now the Hebrew script, show of hands, who would say the left-hand sample is the correct way round? More confused here because you didn't see script earlier on. But we've got a larger number there. Now, just two more variations with this sample here again for the lower one. We have just a few there, yep. And again, the left-hand one here. Everyone's given up, putting their hands up. Okay. Hebrew has historically been set upside down in error over the years. In the early days, one would put it down to the days of Calgon, type falling, pasted up type, falling off a page, and being stepped back by someone who wasn't aware of which way it should go and putting it the wrong way around. But even in this digital age, people seem to actively rotate some Hebrew around and put it the wrong way around. The examples here we have, top left corner here, an article from Visible Language, in which was actually looking specifically at whether the top or lower part of the Hebrew letter was the readable form of it. And that one sample, the top right-hand corner of it, was printed upside down. Then in Baseline magazine, this one was from is the Bedoni issue, I think, in 1990. Again here, the alphabet along the bottom here is all set upside down. And then Hebrew, from a calligraphic point of view as well, we have the Dead Sea Scrolls up in the top right. Again, positioned upside down. And off the DVD cover title sequence from The End of Days, again, someone there must have specifically turned it upside down. In fact, a few months ago in the papers, there was a picture of Victoria Beckham's latest Hebrew tattoo, which again was put upside down. So, that's a good question, actually, yes. There's two possible reasons for this confusion. One is the fact that Hebrew actually is read right to left, not left to right, and so with the open counters facing towards the left, one could be confused and rotated because of the flow. The other possibility is the fact that Hebrew is actually traditionally written to hang down below the line, whereas it's more natural for people to assume things are growing up, like Latin typography sits on the line. And so with all the descenders being positioned as ascenders, it could be the fact that even though more recently the base of the Hebrew has flattened out, it still intrinsically is a letter which hangs from the line and people are turning it upside down. So when we run through this experiment, which I did some years ago as well, firstly, the much higher proportion held the letter upside down as a identified it upside down as being the above sample rather than the correct way around. The script was something new I was going to try because as script is written and developed in Hebrew, it's written on the baseline. And so I was expecting here to find that more and more people selected that as being the correct way around. The other versions we saw at the end, I had made a mirror image. So we corrected for the difference in direction compared to Latin. So the Hebrew was actually now flowing the left to right conventional Latin direction. And still when we did this test, we found more people turned it upside down still, indicating that this hanging of the letters and looking upside down because of this is visually far more disturbing than the fact it's going in a different direction. So the Hebrew alphabet in its correct direction. Here we have the typeface Frank Rule, which was mentioned earlier, and is considered the Times of Hebrew. It's still the most frequently used for newspaper and book printing in Israel, and it was designed 100 years ago to this year by Raphael Frank, who is a Jewish scribe in Leipzig and cut by the Royal Type Foundry in Leipzig. Its design, to briefly mention it, was a big improvement on previous types, which we shall be looking at later, as the vertical strokes, which here are still much weaker than the horizontals, were vastly improved in weight compared to what they had been previously. To identify now the grey letters, of the 22 letters in the alphabet which are in black, the grey ones are final forms of the letters which are to the right of them. And the red dots positioned on them at the moment indicate how they actually formed. Originally, it was actually the final forms of all the four of the grey letters which have a dot in the middle of them. That was the original form, and then through writing them and speed, it slowly bent round and formed, as one can see, the letters to the right of each of them. The exception to that being the letter in the top left-hand corner of a pair, in which the original form is now used for the main word, part of a word, and the final form developed from this. So, unlike the Latin alphabet, where we have an upper and lower case, and we'll use capitals at the beginning of some words, in Hebrew there's only one case, these letters here, and the letters at the end, if they're one of these five letters, will have a different form, but other than that, there's no distinguishing between the beginning of a word and the end. The letters, as we've mentioned earlier, actually hang from the line, and this base of them here is actually something which developed over time and wasn't actually a true part of the letter and relates directly to the limitations of technology as to how it formed like that. And although the Hebrew is written and read from right to left, an interesting point is the actual writing of each individual letter goes in the other direction. As we can see with the green dot and arrow there, a calligrapher would have to actually work out how wide the letter would be in advance, start it, and then move the pen back and down. To complement the Hebrew alphabet, but to go with it, the Arabic numeral set is used, and it is used in the same direction as the Latin alphabet uses the Arabic numerals, going from left to right. For punctuation, again, the same punctuation as used with the Latin alphabet has been adopted, and however, some elements are used in a slightly different way, such as the dash, the makaf, positioned at the top of the letters there, which looks like a hyphen, actually is not a hyphen. A hyphen being used in English to split a word over a line break or the likes. This isn't allowed at all in Hebrew, and the makaf is used when two words need to be joined together. So they're two words which need to be associated to each other, you would use that letter. An interesting point as well with the punctuation is that whereas with the difference in direction, one would expect to reflect the direction of a punctuation. As in the word the, to the left here, and the comma, the letter hey, which actually means be in Hebrew, you'd expect the comma to enclose it, as shown in the centre. However, it doesn't. It is taken, as it's used in the Latin, and positioned on right there, so it's actually drawn to flow on towards the next letter rather than pausing the sentence at that point. Similarly, a question mark as well. You'd expect it to be reflected. The nature of it, as we see it, is it's enclosed, it's the end, it's a final thing. It's almost like a bracket saying, this is the stop, I'm asking a question. Whereas, as used with the Hebrew alphabet, it's actually the open end which is flowing forward. So, to all intents and purposes, the alphabet as we've seen now and the Arabic numerals is all that is used for the day-to-day printing of newspapers or any other publications. However, there is a totally separate alphabet, which is the modern Hebrew script, which is used for handwriting. Naturally, there are some typefaces based on this, as there are with sort of scripts in the Latin alphabet, but they are not used for any serious work, only perhaps for greeting cards and the like, if they're in print. If we now compare these letters to letters from the Dead Sea Scrolls from the 1st century BCE, we can easily identify the letters as being having not changed at all in structure. The few things which have changed, however, are the fact that we'll note the samples here from the Dead Sea Scrolls are reasonably monolinear in form, whereas we have the still quite accentuated horizontal weight on the Frank Rule typeface above here. Also, we have the definite baseline, the top line, which the letters are hanging off, whereas in the older scripts, we had very angled bases to the lines. This is something which has changed over time, and we'll be looking at shortly. So, the point we're going to look into now is this question of this characteristic horizontal stress on the letters, the Hebrew baseline, is it the top or is it the bottom, and then we'll see how Latin typographic conventions apply to the Hebrew, which is moving in the other direction and has so many other mirrors of the Latin alphabet. The characteristic horizontal stroke and stress originated from the pens which it was written with, and then at the point of the invention of printing, it was based then on the styles of the time. There's actually two styles of calligraphic styles. There was what's called the Ashkenazi style, which was used in the areas such as Germany and Poland, which was written with a quill, which gave it the high contrast we can see on the top sample here between the horizontals and verticals. Whereas the Sephardic style from areas such as Spain and Italy and North Africa was written with a reed pen, which actually had a far reduced contrast difference between the horizontal and vertical strokes. It's also worth noting at this point that both letters and styles have, in the vertical, a tendency to slope backward. Well, I'd say slope backwards, bearing in mind the letter is written from the top of a line, the strokes are flowing slightly backwards compared to the reading direction. As we move on to type, we'll notice here, although there are a few centuries of time difference in these samples, we can see that they are very similar in style. The first Hebrew types were copied directly from the written letter, and the main differences being that there's a straightening of that angle we just mentioned on the vertical, which no doubt would have been the constraints of the metal type originally. And also the fact that the base of the letters here has become straight as well. Again, with the Sephardic typeface, we have exactly the same happening here. However, what we found is possibly sort of influenced by the times, the vertical strokes have actually become a bit lighter, so they're actually slightly increased in contrast to what they were when written with the reed pen. As we move forward in time, the Sephardic letter basis was used more frequently for type. However, it was greatly influenced by the likes of Bodoni, with the high levels of contrast, which similarly echoed the Ashkenazic style, which was previously used as well, still is used. Yeah. So now we come back to our Frank Rule type, which we can see here the vertical strokes have increased somewhat in weight. This is actually crucial for the Hebrew letter, because unlike the Latin letter, where one can get away with reasonably thin horizontal strokes, because majority of the information is in the other dimension. However, with Hebrew, both strokes are equally as important to each other, and so applying this increase of contrast really didn't do the Hebrew letter any good. If we now look at just the simple terms here, the effect of the contrast of the letters being in horizontal or vertical, we can see with this letter H, or possible letter H here, comparing it to what would be a final mem in Hebrew, the stressed vertical looks far taller than the Hebrew counterpart. And so with Hebrew, one's already got the issue that because of the stress of the letters, that type will look proportionally smaller size for size. In balance to that, however, with the Latin type, one has serif faces because that helps the eye run it along the line, one of the reasons, whereas that is not necessary in Hebrew when you've already got a stronger horizontal which is drawing you along the line anyway. Nevertheless, the idea of increasing the weight of the verticals in Hebrew has been used and is actually used quite successfully. It's still not sort of accepted for use or usable for large quantities of book text. However, for signage and the like and small quantities of text, it works well. And as we can see here with this, both the Narcus medium and the Narcus tan bold as well, more so in the bold, we have creeping in this stress and increased width of the verticals. Similarly, a few logos here, echoing Latin types, again, all with an increased weight to the vertical stroke rather than the horizontal, which is traditionally out of character to what people see as Hebrew. On the right-hand side, we actually have two street signs on this the same wall, the same word here, one with, which is stressed in the vertical dimension and one in the horizontal dimension. Nevertheless, if one goes to a form of, how did I describe it here? Tacky, yes. Illegible Latin made to look like Hebrew, the element people put in to make it look like Hebrew is the stress to the horizontal. So it has become something which is a feature of the Hebrew alphabet. If we now move on to the Hebrew baseline, which we saw particularly at the point of introduction of printing that it went and got flattened off, this is an effect of, not just of a printing process, but it's happened slightly earlier as well and is linked to the introduction of a vowel system in the Hebrew alphabet, which was introduced between the 6th and 10th century. Although the Hebrew alphabet as it stands here without any vowels, so basically what we've got here is there's no actual vowel sound here, but these are just the consonants in terms of the Latin alphabet. This is perfectly adequate in a country such as Israel today because people are speaking the language and they know how to pronounce their words, and so there isn't an issue. However, at points in history when Hebrew was only used as a religious language for prayer, people forgot how to pronounce words correctly, weren't so familiar with it, and so a vowel system was introduced. And it's still used today, but mainly for religious books, prayer books, and also for teaching children to speak the read and write the language. The vowels take the form of a series of different dot combinations and dashes, predominantly positioned below the letters. All these different vowels need to be able to fit under any of the letters above. There's also the kolam, which is positioned as a dot above the letter, and in one particular case, for sure, just against that letter vav, just sort of the second one in from the left, one line up, which is a one-off where it is positioned there as well. So with the introduction of vowels, this was something which, as we all see through some samples now, it slowly flattened off the base of the Hebrew letter. a sample here from the 10th century, which we'll see, because this was still handwritten and not printed, there wasn't too much of a problem. We have our strong baseline at the top here. We still have an angle to the base, which doesn't actually cause a problem, so when a vowel is underneath it, the wedge shape, rather than it being a parallel space, really wasn't considered too much of an issue. However, over this period, up to the point of printing, the bases of the letters slowly did flatten out slightly, but not to the extent of what the printing press did. An interesting point relating to the vowels being positioned below the letter is originally in the 6th century, there was a vowelization system called the Palestinian system, which was based on dots and dashes positioned above the letter rather than below the letter. Then, from the 7th to 8th century, there was the Babylonian system, which consisted of small Hebrew letters positioned, again, above the letter. And then, finally, the Tiberian system, which is what is used today, which was dots and dashes predominantly below the letter. This ties in quite nicely with where the way accents are put on Latin letters, for example, in French. Bearing in mind our Hebrew letter is hanging down from the line, whereas in Latin we are growing up from the line, so it is the putting an accent on the predominantly on the top of letters in European languages is equivalent to them going below the letter in the Hebrew alphabet. So here we see again this straightening off of the baseline of the letter to accommodate the vowels. A requirement for metal type because of the way it was set, because of the volume of different combinations of vowel and letter one could have, they were set separately. So you justify your line of type, and then you turn it upside down, and you would then place all the vowels on it. So you needed a flat base without too much kerning to actually justify your vowel system below the letters. Then on top of this, to make things even more complex, there's a whole system of cancellation marks which are predominantly placed on top of the letters. We won't go into that now, but basically there was three different sets of justification which was required in Hebrew type, and this really sandwiched it together, forming this strong horizontal top and bottom to the letters. Obviously, in today's technology, such things aren't relevant anymore, but we still have this horizontal base in many typefaces. A report was published in Visible Language in 1980 by Joseph Shimon and David Navon, where they investigated the readability of both the Latin and the Hebrew alphabet based on hiding either the top or bottom half of the letters. This is similar to what was done sort of earlier by Emile Javal's research back in the 19th century in Paris, which he did for the Latin alphabet, where he published the fact that the top part of the Latin alphabet held the key to readability, and by hiding the lower half, one could still read reasonably fluently, whereas hiding the top half, it reduced the legibility quite considerably. Here we have a comparison of Latin against Hebrew, and what this clearly shows is the fact that the readability of the Hebrew is determined by the lower part of the letter. So again, we have the opposite to the Latin letter. Here we have the lower part, and again, what we mentioned about the vowels being along the bottom of the letter, this then falls logically into place, just as the vowels with the Latin letter are placed on top of the letter, which is the more readable part of the Latin letter. This is just showing what they did, the Latin on this side here, both the bottom half hidden and the top half, and then the same for Hebrew. We'll now look at a few typefaces. This is the Corin typeface designed by Eliyahu Corin, specifically for the Jerusalem Bible. What we'll see here is in comparison of the Corin typeface to the Frank Rule typeface, is the fact that he started breaking away from that horizontal top line and bottom line also. He's introduced angles at the top heads of some of these letters here, which were previously reasonably flat, and angling the tops of heads of these letters. When this letter shin takes a dot, which it can take either to the left or the right, shown by the red or green dot, so to avoid confusion with the vowel system, which also consists of dots, it enables one to actually place them within the letter rather than on top or to the side of the letter. Also, we note here that in the Corin Bible typeface, we have a number of letters which he's introduced a slope to the base of them, and even a bit of a slope to the letter indicated in green there, which looks far too much like a Latin C quite often, particularly with its being sloped. He then developed a second typeface called Corin Book. I say a second typeface, it's a variation of the Corin Bible, because he didn't want the Bible typeface to be used for anything other than printing the Bible. This typeface had a number of modifications. He's increased the angle on letters and added the angle to letters which didn't have one before on the base. So again, breaking up that baseline even more, which I see as quite important, whereas we know the more readable part of the letter is the lower part, so the more differences we can have in the letters rather than a straight horizontal line, that's all going to improve legibility. Unfortunately, because I'm not sure myself, personal opinion, whether it's right or not, he also started sloping more of the tops of letters, which is the intention there was to break up the monotony of the straight line along the top. But having said that, the Hebrew was designed to hang from the line, and scribes today still will rule the top line and write the letters hanging down from them, not the top. And so one would question the logic of that. Another point here, if we see the red dotted line in more or less the middle of the screen there, that's two versions of the same letter. Ideally, that letter should hang below the line, but it causes problems in that style if you've got a vowel to put underneath it. And so he created two versions of that letter. So, for example, one rarely has a vowel on the last letter of a word, and so the letter ayin, which descends below the line, would generally be used there, whereas within the word, unless the vowel was accommodated around that, he would use the other version. Again, these are things which, with modern typesetting nowadays, one could automatically work the vowel system around such things and optimise the use of the correct characters. A few examples here of making use of this concept of a Hebrew letter hang from the line and the Latin letter growing up from the line. Type in a circle, normally a problem because half of it looks upside down. If one swaps one word round, you've then actually got two different baselines. However, if one is creating such a design using both Hebrew and English together, there's no problem because the base of both is all around the outside. Another example, Logue added some time ago, not just a Latin letter here, but Latin words, quid est vitae, what is life? And the answer, the broken off bits of the I and the D of quid makes the word chai in Hebrew meaning life. So here we have just again the top bit of the letters broken off, and they actually form Hebrew characters. Okay, we'll now look at a few Latin typographic conventions and how they are transposed into Hebrew. Based on the fact that we're going in a different direction, letters are hanging from a line, how do things translate? Italic is an interesting one. There's no true Italic Hebrew, but as with anything else, people want a slanted version, and so many designers have attempted to create italic Hebrew to go in their typeface. But a big question being, which way should it slant? Well, I say a big question. The actual type designers of the 1950s and so on didn't think it was a question. They went from the old manuscripts, which we mentioned earlier, from the top of the line were bending back down towards the right. And so designers such as Henry Friedlander, whose Hadassah typeface we saw earlier on in Paul's presentation, he designed but never published an italic version of his typeface, which slanted the way he believed it should go, that being a mirror image of the way the Latin typeface flows. He felt it was important to create such a type, an italic form, but never published it because he wasn't happy with it, and it was based on a book which Stanley Morrison sent him originally, in which Stanley Morrison had actually written the introduction to it, explaining how any modern language should have a full set of weights in its typefaces and also italics. And so he was quite determined to create an italic, and although the design of the typeface spanned 27 years from 1931 through the Second World War till it was published in 1958, he still never managed to successfully create an italic. It's also strange because in his comprehensive book he's published about the design of the letter, one of the references he uses is an old cursive script which actually does flow in the opposite direction to what he was attempting. But for some reason, he didn't even seem to approach the concept of it flowing that direction. Another typeface designer, the most prolific of Israeli type designers possibly, Tzvi Narkis, also had failed attempts of designing Italic Hebrew. He took his Narkis linotype, which was designed in 1967, and tried to create an Italic version, again the same direction as Henry Friedlander had tried, but was never happy with it and never released it. He was adamant that Italic should slope in this direction, and believe me, I had plenty of arguments with him over it, and he never came up with anything which he was happy with. His logic was that Italic in Hebrew should show movement, and when one runs or shows movement, one's head moves first, and so to him, the head of the letter was the top. Even though we've talked already about the fact that the Hebrew letter hangs from the line, and so the top is really the bottom. In what would have been earlier than 1984, because that's the furthest back my Letraset catalogues go, they produced a slanted or italic version of his Narkis block letter, slanting in the direction he believes it should go. This was done optically at the time, I believe. He never actually designed a proper italic face, he just designed letters with the assumption that people would bend them whichever way they felt. I think he then gave in to Letraset in 1985, because the 85 catalogue, which includes the Narkis Tam face, actually slopes the other direction for the italic. Again, this wouldn't have been his design, it would have been an optical slanting of the letters, which Letraset would have introduced there. So which of these angles is the correct for italic to show movement forward, and which would be the equivalent of our back slant? My simple explanation to this is italic sits on the line, blow it forward, it's anchored down, and it moves in the direction we're reading. But then with Hebrew, based on the fact that the letter hangs from the line, you fix it at that line and you blow it in the direction you're reading, and it should go that way. And I believe this is a fundamental thing which, although they were great type designers, never quite appreciated at the time, and hence they all tried designing italics in the other direction and were never happy with it. And today, if one looks through the type catalogues and samples around Israel, one finds far more italic sloping this way than the other way. Finally, in 1998, Svinakis actually designed what was here a Hebrew script face, which does actually slope in that direction. I'm not quite sure whether he's actually given in to the fact that it may be better sloping that way, but it actually also contradicts a theory I have, which is the Hebrew script is formed more on a natural baseline at the bottom than the top, and so for that argument, it should actually slope the other way. Okay, briefly, as we're running short of time, another thing we'll quickly look through is line justification. Here we have a Hebrew set of type cases, or the layout of them, from France, and the letters in yellow here we see are all the normal letters, regular letters we're familiar with. We have the vowels in the lower case highlighted in purple. In the pink we have the final forms of the letters, and then what else we have in the light blue in the bottom case is stretched letters. Stretching of letters was a means of justification of Hebrew type. It was forbidden to vary the letter spacing or word spacing in a biblical document, and so the means of justifying type was always through stretching the centre of the letter. And so here we can see the regular forms and the stretch forms, and there's many examples where some letters would have two or three different widths and the most suitable one would be used. Possibly partly for saving space to justify a line, but also for other reasons, is a ligature, which is a combination of the letters Aleph and Lamed, in which in some instances the bottom leg of the Aleph is removed and the top part of the Lamed is added. In other examples, the top part of the Lamed is added to the Aleph, but the Aleph stays intact. So this could be used to save the letter space in order to justify a line. It actually has an interesting history to this ligature. It's traced back to when the Jews spoke Arabic but used the Hebrew alphabet to write it, and in Arabic the letters al means the word V, and there's an Arabic ligature for the letter, the combination al. And so when Arabic was, this then transformed into whenever there was an al in a word, and so when writing with the Hebrew, a similar ligature was created. However, it then gets a bit more complicated, as we will see on the next slide here. Highlighted with the red arrow, we have this form of the ligature of the A, the Aleph and the Lamed. However, what this is being used for here is, as well as saving space, it is so that the name of God isn't written out in full. Those two letters being combined as one means that the word name of God isn't written out in full, and so documents wouldn't be so sacred that one couldn't throw them away because one wasn't writing the name in full. So we have a bit of a sort of contradiction in terms here, because we're saying this is a holy name, but then we're abbreviating it to save space. And I've never quite got to grips with why one would choose, other than the fact that it was the A and the L, why you would use the name of God to save space, to justify a line, when one sees in other parts of books the name in full. So in those instances, it definitely wasn't so that the book wasn't so sacred, because you had the full name written in other places, and so it seems there that it was purely used as a space saver. Other means of justification we see in the light blue boxes here, two widths of the same letter to help justify the line here. Then if we move down to the green arrow, the end character there just below the green arrow, that is the letter Nun, but it's put upside down. This letter was put upside down as a space filler, and historically it goes back to the writing of the Old Testament, where an inverted nun is possibly the only form of punctuation used at all, where in one instance the inverted nun is used around a phrase to pull it out from the rest of it. And so this has a historical background to it, but was used here as a filler. And we'll note that the two letters preceding it are actually then repeated at the beginning of the next line, so you still have the whole word in full as well. Another technique used, shown by the yellow arrow on both pages, is a small letter. They would just drop in a smaller type size in order to fill the line. And finally, in the purple box pulled out at the bottom of the screen here, what originally when I saw this, I thought, the two letters are combined together and that top part of the letter Aleph, the ear of it, if you like, coming off to meet the letter Mem, because it was a similar shape, they'd just taken one away and it would save space. However, one finds the same thing indicated with the purple arrow here, where that letter Mem has the end part of it missing, but the following letter doesn't share the same shape of it, and so it was just a part which was being cut off in order to avoid having to, in order to save space to justify the line. Just briefly to finish up, coming up to date now, reason up to date, this already goes back to 1999, the use of computers and PostScript to stretch letters. Couple of nice examples here where on the left hand side one letter out of each word has been stretched each line for line by the same amount in order to justify the lines, whereas on the right hand side it has just been the last letter of every line which has been stretched as required to fill the line. Now potentially there's a lot of openings here for creativity. These two possibly sort of two extremes, and being able to integrate systems which you could specify, just like you can specify the balance between letter spacing and word spacing in Quark Express or InDesign, to do the same with the Hebrew, but to say, okay, any letters which need stretching, we want them either to stretch by a varying amount, slowly stretching more towards the end of the line, or in reverse even, and one could actually create colour in the page through custom settings, and so there's quite a bit which could be done there, but then there's then the question of integrating into a regular sort of applications, which is an issue which I think is going to be spoken about later on. Incidentally, back in 1980, pre-Macintosh days, on my Apple II, I remember defining a Hebrew font in hexadecimal, in which I created the five most common letters which could be split across two characters and created a filler character so one could actually typeset and make these letters as long or as short as one wanted by just adding in the fillers in the middle. And this is obviously a far more updated version of that. Okay, thank you very much. Do we have any questions?
I'm curious that I'm curious about your theoretical approach to italics. Given that the traditional manuscript form slopes to the left.
Okay, the manuscript form went to the left, the cursive form, which develops from it, slopes in the other direction.
I guess I didn't see
it. Right.
Classic cursive.
Let's just go back. Sorry, those are some extra bits.
You showed some modern cursives and one.
Yes, there's... Okay, it's here. This one at the top here.
Yeah, that one.
Yes, which is sloping round to, from the top coming down towards the left. And It's possible that they didn't look at these because these evolved into the modern-day script, which is considered a different alphabet to the block Hebrew letter. And so we're sort of only guessing here, but it is strange that although the examples which were flowing this way, they didn't go with them. Having said that, one possibility, the reason why the block Hebrew sloped in the way it did, was when writing Hebrew manuscripts, there's very tight laws about letters not flowing into each other, not touching each other, and not to be rushing the writing of it. And so possibly by flowing it backwards against the direction you were going, it was a means of showing that one wasn't rushing the actual manuscript.
So a clockwise direction would be faster than a counterclockwise direction.
Correct.
Would be slower.
Yes. If starting from the top, if you were running the bottom of your line as you moved it down towards where the next letter was going to go, it would be considered rushing, moving forward, which is what italic is meant to show. Whereas by going the other way, it was a sign that it wasn't being rushed and every letter was taken care of by itself.
So the key point here is that the cursive you're showing here is, you're saying that it's actually fairly typical for a cursive.
They varied in how they were written. There's examples of both. However, one could argue the actual proof nowadays is the fact that one had two great type designers who could never get it to work in the other direction, and nowadays, working in this direction, there are lots of cursive variations of Hebrew which are accepted. And so it seems to be accepted as looking more natural and giving the correct message of movement. In fact, there's an interesting shop sign I forgot to include in here for an air conditioning company. Air conditioning showing wind and movement, which has an italic that's it was actually all in caps italic, which didn't quite give the right effect for the Latin version of it. And then the Hebrew, which was flowing again, as shown for the Hadassah this way, which sort of formed a wall, if you like. Whereas had it actually flowed the other way, it would have, the Latin and the Hebrew would have flowed into each other and would have both shown the movement. Yes, right. They're both being written in the same direction, and they both had a tendency to move in that direction. Yeah. Yes. Okay.
There's one thing that didn't address, and that was the size of the arrows. What should we do when we have a typeface and we want to add to it?
rather stick to the capital weight or to the exit, or should we treat them as small caps?
Good question. Hebrew tends to work best with Latin faces which have a large exit, so that one can actually set them to match or be slightly larger than the exit, because depending on which or what type of Latin face one is using, if you're using one with a vertical stress to it, it is going to look higher anyway than the Hebrew as well, and so one would want to sort of put the Hebrew slightly above the exit.
So you are in favor of scaling it to scaling people to the size slightly above the exit, not on the capital height?
Correct, yes. If you go to the capital height as well, you have an ascender on the letter lamed, which is then going way above that, which will cause all sorts of issues also. Yes, it's... yes, that one there, exactly, yes. I mean, that is something which was... I actually had an interesting conversation with Tzvi Narkis about this, because he, couldn't disagree with the fact that Hebrew is written from the top, but he said, in typographic terms, the letter sits on the bottom of the letter, and that is how he designs them. But to me... I only see that as reducing legibility, because the bottom part of a letter is the more readable part, and by keep putting them all in a horizontal line, rather than having different slopes on different letters, you're just making the letters look far more monotonous, and then getting the name they're known as, which is the Hebrew square letter, because of the squareness of them, which really isn't how they originated, but caused by fitting them into a typesetting system which wasn't developed specifically for the Hebrew or within the limitations of what was available at the time.
So it sort of suffers from the same problem as Cyrillic, many Cyrillic diagrams.
Right.
That sort of the top and the bottom.
Yes.
Almost corridor of the variation.
Exactly, and if one can get away, that is something which one has become used to in Hebrew since the time of printing, and it's something which would greatly enhance the Hebrew alphabet if one broke away from it and actually started seeing Hebrew hanging down. But having said that, someone at the Batanal Art College, the head of the art college some years ago, said to me, it is natural for things to grow up, not to hang down. And so you've got a contradiction here, which with the Indian alphabet, you actually have a line which they can be seen to hang off, whereas with the Hebrew it is a more of an imaginary line made from the individual letters.
There's something that occurred to me. The part of the remark that Hebrew suffers from a defect, like Cyrillic, that it isn't Latin. Essentially, that's what you're saying.
No.
Well, sorry, it has to do, okay, good night.
Process of unification that happened in Cyrillic. Mm-hmm. I mean, I didn't say it, I never used the word Latin. I actually meant that the process that the Cyrillic went in the Petrine form, which was basically breaking away from a somewhat more dynamic structure at the top and the bottom, and sort of squeezing it into a corridor. You can see the same.
That's what I was doing for me when I rephrased that as. Hebrew and Cyrillic share a feature that they are different from Latin in that respect.
No, I don't think I ever mentioned that.
But the point I'm actually going to make is that in the Latin tradition, two rather different manuscript styles or script styles were merged into one family. And the bottom line is that you want to create a textual contrast within a certain consistency. Have there ever been designers of Hebrew who have been looking for solutions, not by trying to slant in any direction, but by trying to create the necessary contrast by using any existing potential for that within their own That's a question for you.
Yes, thank you. Yes, I was actually going to look at Stephen there and see if he had any. Or Nigel.
Occasional use of the Rashi script to distinguish different reference systems. If one thinks of a page of Mishnah Berurah,
yeah.
Different letters from different systems of Talmud, using those two different
yes.
alphabets. But no, I don't think likely, not within my experience.
Yeah, I would agree with that. I think.
Here we are. Okay. This was the bit I cut out because I thought I was going to run out of time, but. Yes, and here's the Rashi script above. So he took some of the other scripts and tried to create an upper and lower case alphabet, which interesting in itself, and if one combines this with the concept of a Hebrew letter hanging from the line, where here we have lowercase symbols on the lower line, there's a lot of sort of interesting sort of things going on here. And he basically also did serif and sans serif versions. I think this was Kazlon, and italics as well.